fears and stereotypes about immigrants have existed for as long as this has been a country, and even predating its founding. I'm going to start by sharing some examples, many which are offensive and familiar. I strongly believe that we must acknowledge our ugliness and the darker side of humanity if we have any hope of overcoming it and bettering ourselves. Benjamin Franklin, one of our founding fathers, said this about German immigrants to Pennsylvania. Quote, "Few of their children learn English. Unless the stream of their importation could be turned, they will soon so outnumber us that all the advantages we have will not be able to preserve our language, and even our government will become precarious." That was in the 1750s, even before we were a country. Another founding father, John Jay, who also became the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, said this, quote, "We should build a wall of brass around the country." Sound familiar? He was talking about the, quote, Catholic alien invaders. In the 19th century, this is Lyman Beecher, father of Harriet Beecher Stowe. He was speaking about English immigrants when he said in 1934, quote, "What means the paying of the passage and emptying out upon our shores such floods of pauper emigrants? The contents of the poorhouse and the sweepings of the streets, multiplying tumults and violence, filling our prisons and crowding our poorhouses and quadrupling our taxation, and sending annually accumulating thousands to the poll to lay their inexperienced hand upon the helm of our power." In a congressional hearing in 1920, there was this strongly anti-Semitic quote, "They are coming in such numbers that we are unable adequately to take care of them. If there were in existence a ship that could hold 3 million human beings, then 3 million Jews of Poland would board to escape to America." In World War II, General John DeWitt was in charge of the Western Defense Command and leader of the Fourth Army. He said this, quote, "There isn't such a thing as a loyal Japanese, and it is just impossible to determine their loyalty by investigation. It just can't be done." Beloved Dr. Seuss drew racist propaganda cartoons during World War II, playing upon the suspicion and hatreds and fears of Japanese Americans, such as my mom's family. So generalities and stereotypes allow one to ignore the depth and breadth of humanity represented by each individual story and experience that contributes to the rich tapestry of our society. I want to share a little bit about my family's story, a story that has been preserved and presented in the book just mentioned, co-written by my mother and my eldest brother. It was just published this year. My grandfather came over from Japan in 1904. He settled in the Hood River and in 1911 was joined by his wife, who was a picture bride. If they were alive today, Grandpa would be 144 and Grandma would be 132. They were married for over 50 years, had 8 children, 7 of whom Grandpa delivered at home. He would have delivered Mom too, but she presented a unique challenge. They survived and thrived through the worst period in U.S. history for Japanese Americans. They settle in Hood River. Here they are with their 2 eldest children. My Aunt Masako is standing, and my oldest Uncle Tot is in her lap. Here is Uncle Todd, a little bit older, on the left side, and my mom, the youngest, is in the center with her 2 of her other brothers, Itsuo and Uncle Gene. They lived in Hood River and raised fruit, and some of those orchards are still in the family today. Before Pearl Harbor was bombed, 2 of my uncles were already in the service. My uncle Masaaki, or better known as Half, joined in June of 1941. He was underage and had to get a parental signature which my grandpa wasn't too eager to give, and he threatened to forge his father's name, so okay, he joined. Uncle Tot joined. He was drafted just about a week before Pearl Harbor was bombed. By war's end, three more of my uncles joined. That's Uncle Min and Uncle Gene. Uncle Gene graduated while he was in camp and went into service. And at the very end, after they were released from camp, and just before the war ended, my Uncle Itsuo joined the U.S. Armed Forces. So all five of my uncles served in the Armed Forces, despite the rest of the family being incarcerated. Mom was just in the fourth grade when Pearl Harbor was bombed. Pearl Harbor occurred on a Sunday. The days before and after that weekend for her were like night and day. This is a quote from her book. On Friday, December 5th, 1941, I went to school as usual and was treated the same as I had always been from the first day of the first grade at the Barrett School in 1938. I had attended the Barrett School for more than 3 years and had been fully accepted. Little did I realize what the weekend's events would mean for me and my family over the next 4 years and more. On Monday, I was in for a big surprise. I was spit upon twice and called Jap, and some children would no longer play with me at recess. I was hurt and bewildered. At 9 years old in the fourth grade, I had never known discrimination before this moment. It was only a preview of the treatment I was to receive from grown-ups in Hood River 4 years later. After FDR signed Executive Order 9066, the military was authorized to define security zones from which, quote, any or all persons, unquote, could be excluded. Any or all persons. But it was only used against the Japanese Americans. This is a map showing the exclusion area, which basically is the entire West Coast. If you had any Japanese American heritage, you had to leave. They were hoping you'd leave voluntarily. How many people could do that? You can also see on this map, black triangles indicated the quote-unquote assembly centers, and the red boxes for the more permanent quote-unquote relocation centers that they were forced to go into. All up and down the West Coast, posters like this went up. If I zoom in, you will see that it is directed to, quote, all persons of Japanese ancestry, both alien and non-alien. What does non-alien mean? They had to assemble at a specific location. It could only bring what they could carry. Every family was assigned a family number, and every bag and every person had to have a tag with that number. Mom is 92. She will never forget her family number, 16339. Here's a map showing the journey that my mom's family was forced to take, starting with the red dot in Hood River. They were first taken by train down to Pinedale Assembly Center. That was a temporary prison camp for several months. The assembly centers were temporary prison camps where over 120,000 Japanese Americans were housed until the more permanent camps could be completed. They were then transferred to Tule Lake, California, which is just south of Klamath Falls, about 10 or so miles on the California border. They were housed there, imprisoned there for a year. And they were transferred to Heart Mountain, Wyoming, just outside of Cody, for 2 more years until they were finally allowed to go home to Hood River. There are many euphemisms used to describe this period, but I want to focus on one. Almost everybody still refers to the permanent camps as internment camps. Now, although that is the most common term, I encourage you to reject this term. There is a legal definition of internment, but I'm going to guess that 99% of the people don't know what that is and have only used the word, only heard the word internment used with regards to Japanese American incarceration. The definition of internment means the imprisonment of alien enemies captured legally and imprisoned under the terms of the Geneva Convention. Over 120,000 Japanese Americans were imprisoned. They were not alien enemies. They were not captured on the battlefield. They were never tried or charged or convicted of any crimes. Over two-thirds of them were U.S. citizens, like my mom, because they were born in the United States. Although her mother and father had lived peacefully in Oregon for over 30 years before Pearl Harbor, they could not become citizens because racist anti-Asian laws prevented or banned people from becoming naturalized until the 1950s. They would have gladly been citizens, but they couldn't. So you can see what the problem with using the word internment is. My grandparents and my mom's family had no loyalty to the Japanese emperor or Japanese empire. They would gladly have been citizens, but they were not allowed to. So for that reason, I invite you to reject the term internment camp, interns, internees, all that sort of stuff. So what should you use? Prison camp? Incarceration camp? Concentration camp? That term was actually used by FDR and his administration. I leave that to you. So they were first taken to assembly centers. These were temporary prison camps, and mom's first assembly center, well, the assembly center mom's family went to was Pinedale in Fresno, California. You can imagine how hot that was. Here's a quote from her book describing it. The security precautions at the assembly center were extensive. A fine meshed fence rose from the ground to about 8 or 10 feet, and above that were 3 or 4 rows of electrified barbed wire. The fences were right up close to the barracks. So when you looked out the window, you were having to stare at this 8-foot-high fence. At each corner of the camp were watchtowers manned 24 hours a day by sentries, U.S. military police, many of whom were less than enthusiastic about their duty, if not sheepish. From these towers shone searchlights after dark that moved over the tar paper barracks all night. As I lay in bed, I could feel the searchlight cross my face in spite of my closed eyes, as it made its wide, measured, predictable sweep over the camp. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. As we moved to the relocation center, quote unquote, at Tule Lake, where there was no searchlight, I still saw the light through my closed eyes, even in my sleep. It was a few months' time before I could rid myself of the searchlight's image. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That was imprinted on my brain. Here's the interior of a typical barrack. These were thrown together. I read that these took 56 minutes to build. No foundation, no insulation, just basically boards with tar paper for walls. They were separated into separate units for families. One bare light bulb hanging from the ceiling, a potbelly stove for heat, and the only furniture were army cots. Any other furniture you had to scrounge or build or do something to make shift. It was bitterly cold in the winter and blazing hot in the summer. Here's a typical mess hall, which is basically a barrack without all the partitions. There was lines for everything, lines for food, lines for showers and toilets. Food was pretty unhealthy. I mean, I've read government reports from the time that said that the food was unsuitable for growing children. How would you like to use toilets like this? No partitions, no privacy, no dignity. You're basically brushing, you know, rubbing elbows with the person next to you. Showers were the same. It was humiliating. Here's a photograph of Tule Lake present day, with Abalone Hill in the background, and a photograph of the camp of Tule Lake. At the time my mom's family was in Tule Lake, there was about 11,000 prisoners. And the camp was designed to hold up to 15,000, but the population actually peaked at almost 19,000 prisoners after Tule Lake became a quote-unquote segregation center. So how did that come about? After about a year of housing and feeding 120,000 plus people, the government and the military said, you know, it's costing us an awful lot to do this, And we really need able-bodied men to serve in the armed forces. We want to draft guys out of the camp to serve. And we know some of them are loyal. How can we figure that out? In the military's wisdom, they came up with a loyalty questionnaire. About 100 questions. All adults had to answer them. The most important questions were, oh, here's the Tule Lake camp, and I'm pointing at the barrack where Mom's family was incarcerated. Here's the loyalty questionnaires, questions number 27 and 28, which were the most important. 27, are you willing to serve in the armed forces in the United States on combat duty anywhere ordered? Wherever ordered. Well, this would be a rather unusual question to ask my grandfather. He's in his 60s. He can't become a United States citizen, and you want him to serve in combat duty. Okay. Second question is even more problematic. It's really two questions boiled into one. Will you swear unqualified allegiance to the United States of America and faithfully defend the United States from any and all attacks by foreign and domestic forces? Question A. And question B, do you forswear any form of allegiance or obedience to the Japanese emperor or any other foreign government power or organization? Well, for starters, how many people know the word forswear and what that means? Basically, it means to reject, renounce, you know. So clearly, the military was hoping you would answer yes to both these questions, thus showing your loyalty. But if you answered yes to question 28, couldn't one conclude that, well, I was pledging allegiance to the Japanese emperor, but now I renounce that? It's kind of like asking somebody, when did you stop beating your wife? It's a no-win question to answer. So you can imagine how many people struggled with these questions and were insulted to be asked these kinds of questions. Some people answered with conditions. Yes, when my family can be allowed to leave the camps. No, conditions were not allowed. You either could answer yes or no. A yes with conditions equals a no. And anybody who answered no to both of these questions was considered disloyal and a threat. And so all the prisoners from all the 10 camps who answered no to this question were brought to Tule Lake. The people who were in Tule Lake who answered yes, yes to both these questions were given the option to be moved to another camp. And fortunately, that's what my grandfather did. He said, this is not a time to be proud. I'm going to answer yes to both these questions. And our family was moved to Heart Mountain, Wyoming. Meanwhile, the population at Tule Lake exploded to 8,700 plus prisoners. And if you can imagine if all of the majority of them had answered no to both these questions, they were probably not too happy. They were pretty angry. There were protests, there were hunger strikes. They built a stockade, a prison within a prison, that the walls still stand today with graffiti in Japanese and English scratched on the walls, bloodstains, pictures of broken bats. It was terrible. My family avoided that. So when people hear, oh, you were in Tule Lake, no, we were moved before it became a segregation center. Mismanagement of this life-defining questionnaire contributed to Tule Lake having the largest number of Japanese Americans defined as disloyal, including those who answered no with qualifying comments, when my family is released or when my rights are restored. So after answering yes, yes, my mom's family was moved to Heart Mountain, Wyoming. Here's a photograph. There's Heart Mountain in the distance, and you can see the rows of tar paper barracks. Here's a map of the Heart Mountain camp superimposed over today's present-day farmland. That little blue dot up in the top left corner in the 28 block, that was my mom's barrack. This camp had 10,700 plus prisoners and constituted the third largest city in the state of Wyoming at the time. The third largest city. Now, Mom was just a little girl. She was just a fourth to sixth grader in camp. So her experience was vastly different from that of her elder siblings and her parents. At home in Hood River, she'd walk every day to school. She'd come home, work in the orchard and the farm. She didn't really have many play dates. In camp, she had a lot of free time and a lot of kids her age to play with. So she actually had a pretty good time. You know, the food wasn't that great, but she was not aware of the greater context of what was going around. Her parents, of course, and her siblings were worried, will our brothers survive the war? Will they be injured? Will we have a home to come home to? What's going to become of us? So her experience of camp wasn't as bad as it was for others. Her trauma occurred after they came home from camp. So here she is at Harp Mountain. Harp Mountain is just over the shoulder of her mom on the left side there. Here she is in a Christmas pageant, dressed as an angel holding a microphone. She likes to joke, once she was handed a mic, she didn't stop talking. We are glad for that. The vast majority of people who were in camp never talked about their experience. Many of their ancestors didn't even know what happened until after they died. Mom is very rare in that she's talked about this for as long as I've been alive, probably longer, and we're grateful for that. So finally it was determined that it was time to allow the Japanese Americans out of the camps. Well, being fed a constant diet of anti-Japanese racist propaganda, most of the communities were not happy to have them come home. Full-page editorials like this would appear in newspapers, unwelcoming them home. Japes, for those of you who don't know, is a combination of the word Japanese and apes. And after these articles, there would be a long list of signatories, and they'd look at them. Oh, there's the doctor, and the dentist, and my teacher, all the people they'd known all their lives. They'd go through the list and see who didn't sign them. And those were a precious few. Most businesses, when they came home, had big red no Jap trade signs in their windows. And even when my uncles, coming home from service in their full dress uniforms, would be refused service. Mom's family was the first family to return to Hood River. This is a picture of my mom's aunt, Mika. She just died a couple years ago at age 99, happily hoeing in the garden. There's my grandfather pouring water in the tractor. There's grandma smiling in the orchards. The WRA, the War Relocation Authority, was the organization charge of building the camps and forcing Japanese Americans in the camps. They took these photographs, and we found out later they were used as propaganda. Receiving these newspapers in the camps about how unwelcome they were to come home, people were afraid to leave the camps, even when they were allowed to. Many had no home to go home to, or farm, or anything, and plus, with these really scary headlines, they didn't want to go. So they posted these pictures of this happy Japanese family. They resettle in Hood River. Everything's great. Posters were posted like these in other camps to show the Japanese that it was safe to go home. So my mom's family was used as propaganda. So jumping forward, this is a picture of me from this last month. As I said, many of the orchards that my grandfather started a century ago are still being in the family today. I'm standing in front of a big fruit bin with my family name Asai on it, and I asked my cousin about the people who do the work. So this is a bin that holds about 1,000 to 1,100 pounds of pears. A good picker can pick 6 bins of pears a day. That's about 3 tons, or about 10,000 pears. A top picker can pick 4 tons. 99% of those pickers are Hispanic, either U.S. citizens of Mexican heritage or immigrant laborers. It's tough work. You're carrying bags of up to 50 pounds on your shoulders on top of a ladder, reaching out and grabbing fruit. A typical work day lasts for 6 hours. I asked my cousin, how many non-Hispanics have ever tried to pick for you? And he answered, 1 in over 30 years. And he had to fire him after one day. After 2 hours, he found him asleep at the base of the pear tree, and by the end of the day, he had barely filled half a bin. Immigrants work in all areas of our society: healthcare, service, hospitality, agriculture. I provide this as one counterexample to the common claim we hear that they're stealing our jobs. This is a picture of Mom standing at the approximate location of the barrack in Harp Mountain, Wyoming. This is in 2019. She's the last surviving member of her generation. She's the youngest of 8 kids. She's 92 years old, still going strong, still driving. We're taking her to Japan in November. The story that she shares is not only one of darkness and hatred, but of perseverance and grit. It also tells about the precious few courageous friends and neighbors who stood up for families like hers and spoke up against injustice when so many others remained silent. I want to thank the Tigard Library for hosting us and TVCTV for recording this talk. Mama's 92, and she'll be delighted to answer any questions you have, any of them. She's strong and feisty, so you don't need to go easy on her. Ask her anything. Please welcome my mom, Mitzi Asai Loftus. So if you will raise your hand and tell me your question, I will repeat it for mom. Anybody? Don't be shy.
Well, I'll get them started.
Oh, here's this lady.
Well, I was going to say, when you returned back to Hood River, what was the community attitude towards you?
When you returned to Hood River, what was the community attitude toward you?
Well, the community was there, but they weren't there. I walked to and from school a mile and a quarter every day for a year and a half alone. Nobody played with me at recess or before or after school. So the teacher took pity on me, and I cleaned the erasers back when we had blackboards and watered the flowers every day. That got very, very old. We could not buy groceries. So Safeway, fortunately, had an early army officer who was discharged, who became manager, and he said, "What's going on here? Anybody who's got an American dollar is welcome here." So we were able to buy from Safeway, which at that time was owned by Standard Oil. We were also having problems getting gas for our underground tanks. Since we were farmers, we got extra ration stamps for our tractors and trucks. And nobody would deliver gas. And so Standard Oil finally delivered gas to our pumps. We were able to buy in Safeway. So we didn't have to decide where we're going to go shopping. There was only one place we could buy things. We had a hard time getting mechanic work. So I remember my brother, who was 16 years old and just got his license. He was so short, he had to sit on the edge of the seat of the truck with his legs outstretched to barely touch the gas pedal or the brakes. And we had to drive 15 miles up to Parkdale, which is at the foot of Mount Hood, to get gas. We were that desperate. And so the WRA, which is a government organization, was trying to help us get readjusted to our homes. Had a representative would come almost daily, at least weekly, to help us with these problems. And they got on it right away. So they eventually, another gas company, started driving their trucks to our farms to fill our gas tanks.
Why don't you tell about the honor roll?
The what?
The honor roll.
Oh, the honor roll. In almost every town in Oregon, there was what was called the honor roll, which is a list of the names of all the servicemen from that county. And in Hood River, they had one like that on the wall of the county courthouse. There were 16 Japanese-American boys on that list, which were erased by the American Legion Post in Hood River. And that got national publicity. Yay, Hood River, Oregon made the New York Times for the first time. And there was such an outcry against that action that the National American Legion Post sent a message saying, "If you put those names back." And they said, "We don't want to and we're not gonna." And they said, "If you don't put the names back, you're gonna lose your charter." And they said, "Okay, we'll put them back, but only because we don't want to lose our charter." So they did put the names back, and I remember my first thing coming back from Heart Mountain, Wyoming to my hometown. I was so happy to look up on the honor roll to see if my two brothers' names were up there. And indeed they were. They had scraped the wood free of their names so successfully the wood was all rough and they couldn't paint over it again. So they had to drive nails or pegs in, write their names on another piece of board, and hang them. So the 16 names stood out from all the rest. So that's what happened with that.
Yes. What is your reaction to the anti-immigrant rhetoric in the country now?
I think it's always been there, but it doesn't have to be. And I have to hope that it doesn't have to continue to be so. I felt very discouraged at times, but I think the folks that push that kind of message want us to be discouraged, and we must not be. Must each one of us do something that we can do. Each one of us have a part that can be exercised. Unfortunately, we have a lot of unexercised Americans. We just need to have a little stronger backbones. And there are, when we returned to Hood River, I can actually, to this day, from the 1940s, remember on the fingers of my two hands the names of the people who stood up. I can tell you their names, and I have pictures. I think one, oh, there's one of them, Carl and Hazel Smith, our good neighbors. Hazel was a cousin to Ralph Sherbin, who had one of the stores 1 mile from my house that I passed every day on my way to school. Both stores had no Jap trades in them, signs in their doors. And I could hardly believe it because Ralph Sherbin, her cousin, came to us before we were sent off to the camps with tears in his eyes, and he gave us a address book and said, be sure to write to me, we'll stay in contact. And when we came back home, he had a no Jap trade sign in his window. One day, Hazel went into the store and her cousin said, Hazel, I don't like the way you're dealing with this Jap situation. And she said, what do you mean? I suppose you're saying you don't approve of our housing Min Asai, which is my brother, until his house opens up. And she said, well, I suppose you don't want me seen in your store. Well, I don't wish to do business with you anymore. And she walked out of her cousin's house, and they never spoke to each other until both of them died. That's the kind of courage it takes. The people who supported us and helped us suffered along with us. Some of the stores wouldn't even sell to them because they had no Jap trade signs, and they wouldn't sell to people like Hazel.
About Reverend Burgoyne.
And this is Reverend Sherman Burgoyne of the Methodist Asbury Methodist Church in Hood River. He helped the Japanese community very much, so that his congregation eventually asked the bishop of the Methodist Church to remove him, and he was sent away to Shedd, Oregon. If you know where that is in Oregon, that's the kind of treatment he got for helping us. And his the woman there is Mrs. Max Moore. She owned an electric store in town, and that's the honor roll that I referred to. It went the stretch from over here all the way across this courthouse and down.
So at the end of most of Mom's talks, what she will say is, it's not the mean people who threw a rock through their window or stole gas from their underground.
Or yelled at me every day and sicked their dog at me.
Yeah. Those people didn't hurt them. It was the good people who knew what was going on and remained silent. They might privately talk to you and say, you know, we care about you, but in the street, they would pretend that they didn't know you. So her message is, you need to be a Reverend Burgoyne. You need to be a Carl and Hazel Smith and speak up when you see injustice.
Or you need to be a Mrs. Mahler, my neighbor.
Yes.
Who's a tough gal. She'd get into a store with a no Jap trade sign on, and she'd pick up something maybe she didn't even need, and she'd go to pay for it, and she'd say, oh, by the way, my maiden name is Oberteufer. That's German, you know. Does that make any difference? And the clerk was just dumbfounded at this. And she I didn't need this anyway, and she'd throw it down and walk out of the store. She did a lot of things like that that would make a whole book.
Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you for sharing your story. I imagine if I were in your shoes, I would struggle with bitterness and forgiveness. and I wonder how you have handled that over the years.
How have you handled this without becoming bitter? How have you come to a point of peace or forgiveness, if you have?
I have to thank my parents most of all, and particularly my father, who is very much of a practicing Zen Buddhist. And he taught us non-verbally through his life and his actions. I don't recall his ever saying something bad about anybody, even the ones, the worst people who treated us so badly. He never returned unkindness for kindness. And so I didn't understand or realize that until I was well into my 50s. As I reflected back, I even had a discussion with him when I was in the middle of my university years, when somebody said, "Oh, your dad's a Zen Buddhist, tell us about Zen Buddhism." I said, "Gosh, I don't know anything about Zen Buddhism." "Well, didn't your father, your parents take you to—" "No." "Didn't they preach or tell you about Zen?" "No." "Well, how do you—" "Well," so I went home to ask my dad. And I said to him, "You know, Mrs. Steele was my first grade teacher, and I was a teacher's pet, very clearly, and she kept the people she liked in second grade and sent half of the second grade on to the other teacher who took the other half in the third grade. And I would get my schoolwork done, and she'd send me on errands to her husband's store. He owned the other store on that corner that I told you I had to pass every day. And he had a no Jap trade sign in his store after the war. But before the war, I used to go up to run errands for his wife. And when I got home, she would not speak to me, would not recognize me. And when I'd see her any place, I'd try to catch her attention, she'd either turn away or walk away. I remember standing in the row in the bank here, and she was here, and I saw her, and I caught her eye, and I started to walk toward her, and she left the bank without doing her business. And so I was feeling very lonely, and with the dog being threatening me every day to and from school, I decided it wasn't any fun being Japanese. I decided I'd like to be 200% American. My given name, Japanese name, is Mitsuko, and I thought, I think I'll become Mitzi Gaynor. I changed my name to Mitzi because I graduated from an 8th grade elementary school, but to go to junior high school, I had to get on a bus and go 5 miles to town. And I thought, the kids in town don't know Mitsuko at all. So I'll just be Mitzi after this. And I got on the bus, went to junior high school, and when my report card came.
She didn't tell her family when she changed her name, she just did it.
I didn't tell anybody. And when I got home, my Zen Buddhist father looks at the report card with Mitzi on it, and guess what? He smiles, and he looks at me, and he smiles. Does he ask me any questions? No. Does the subject come up? I didn't bring it up, he didn't bring it up, it never came up. So I became Mitzi, and I've been Mitzi ever since.
But you started to talk about what you asked your father about Mrs. Steele.
Yes.
Yes. So I asked my father. Now, Mrs. Steele was my teacher for 2 years, and she won't even speak to me. She walks away, and maybe she's afraid to come out and be friendly in public. Do you think I should go to her house and try to befriend her again? And my father said, "Well, you grew up in a Christian church. I've read the Bible from cover to cover. I know what it says. You have to walk the second mile, turn the other cheek." He said, "I come from a Buddhist background, and the way I see it, it would be no favor to her if you did that, because each person is responsible for the building of your own self and your reputation and your character. And if somebody comes to help you get over the bumps, then you can never have the pride of developing your own character on your own." So in my case, I wouldn't do it, but it's up to you. Well, it was a hard lesson. I didn't really understand what he was saying, but I've appreciated more and more each year. And so that's what I tried to say to you. You need to build up your own character by on your own without a lot of help from people who, to encourage you or to hold you up.
What do you say about anger?
Any negative emotions you may have, whether it be anger, guilt, sadness even, all those negative emotions stay right here if you harbor them, and that just keeps growing and it will kill you. He didn't say that in words. I'm putting words in my dad's mouth, but that's what he taught us. And so I have learned, I guess very early on, I took on that message. That's why I've always had kind of a happy face. People always consider me, talk about me as being a happy person. So you don't see any of the sadness, the grief, or the anger that I might have had, because I've either gotten rid of them or I've hidden them successfully. And you can do it too. He has to help my ears. My ears have gotten a little weak in 90 years.
She's asking about the book Stubborn Twig and the Yasui family, and what, if any, relationship there was between the Asais and the Yasuis.
Very definitely. My father and Mr. Yasui were very close friends. In fact, there are some things about my father who knew what was going on in Mr. Yasui's mind. So much so that the Yasui family children were siblings were just almost parallel to ours. I can tell you, Min was the same age as my brother, so and so. Anyway, we were very close. My father used to take me by hand to the store where Mr. Yasui had his Japanese store. And he had a big glass case with a lot of valuable stuff inside. And on top, there was a round bowl with candy in it. And I'd be in that store with my father. And after my dad and Mr. Yasui would have a conversation, he'd look and see my face staring at that glass bowl full of candy. And he said, oh, and he would reach in there and give me a piece of candy. And that's the last memory I have of Mr. Yasui. And just recently, a letter was found in the house where I was born, where my nephew actually still lives. He found this letter written to him, to my father, from Mr. Yasui. And he said, it was translated and it said, "Dear Elder Brother." And that letter, well, we donated it to the Oregon Historical Society where they have a whole Yasui collection. Yes, we're very close to that. Yuka was a Fulbright nurse to Japan about 4 or 5 years before I went to Japan as a Fulbright teacher to teach English.
And so Mr. Yasui's son, Min, or Minoru Yasui, was the one who took one of the three Supreme Court cases all the way to the Supreme Court and lost. When Min Yasui was in imprisonment in camp, my mom's father went door to door to collect money for Min Yasui's legal defense. Many people closed their door in his face because they thought he was causing trouble. But there is a very close relationship between the Asais and the Yasuis.
Did you create the bottom of your dress? Are you a quilter?
Are you a quilter? Did you create your dress?
I'm embarrassed to tell you, I was telling my family today, I have a perfect four-piece matching outfit. I think I bought these, maybe. I think I got this in a rummage sale. And somebody gave this to me last year. And my son and his wife gave me this necklace when they were traveling across the United States a few years ago. But I'm perfectly four-piece matched.
So no, she did not. Anyone else? Yes. Can you tell us what it was like to be a student in camp?
Well, I was really happy because I had all these kids that I played with every day, so I knew them all very well. We had, you know, every occupation that a person had, was expected to do that job in the camps. If you're a doctor or teacher, a doctor or a dentist or nurse or whatever. But there was only one occupation that was not allowed to be practiced by a Japanese person in the camp. Guess what that was?
Teacher.
What were they thinking that the teacher could tell us that would be against the war effort? I didn't get to the
every
question.
Every day they gave, they recited the Pledge of Allegiance behind barbed wire.
Oh, yes, yes. I was always a good student, so I was happy in school. That was the happiest place for me, except on those that 2 years right after we returned from the camps. I was valedictorian of my class, and I was a senior at the University of Oregon when I received a phone call, and this man said, I understand you want to study abroad in France, and the Rotary Club in Hood River has nominated you to be to compete for a fellowship to study abroad. And I said, are you sure? And he said, why do you say that? I said, who are you? He said, well, I'm Wayne Foster. I said, I don't recognize that name. Have you lived in Hood River long? He said, oh, I'm the new superintendent of schools. And I said, oh, I see. And he said, why do you say that? Obviously, he didn't know anything that you just heard that happened, especially in Hood River. And so he, being an educator, the superintendent of schools, looked at the high school records and the college records and decided I was the best candidate for the Rotary Club to sponsor me. And the Rotary Club were not helpful or kind to us those first few years. So I couldn't imagine the Rotary Club nominating me. So he nominated me, but everybody else on the committee was too embarrassed to say why they voted against me, so they all voted for me. But I didn't get it. I came in second to a young man who was going to Linfield College, and one of the judges was a friend to Mrs. Smaller, my neighbor Mrs. Smaller, the one who said she was Oberkäufer. She told me that he told her Mitzi should have gotten that fellowship, but she didn't because of two things. What were they?
Race. Gender and race.
Gender and race, yes. She's a girl, she's Japanese. So I didn't get to go to France.
So here's pictures of her report cards in 46 and 47. In 46, she's Mitsuko, and in 47, she's Mitzi. Yes, sir. The question is about coming home from camp. How is it that we had a farm? Most people lost their businesses, their homes, their farms.
Good. If you're a fruit farmer, you could get on 20 acres and hard work, you could possibly feed your family. My father used to say, if you raise apples, you will never get rich, but you can feed a family. He was right until economic globalization came, and I'm glad he was dead by that time because that's no longer true. If you're a truck gardener, that is a person who raises vegetables, you have to have a large acreage. So most Californians and Washingtonians who were vegetable farmers had to lease like 100 acres in order to raise enough vegetables to make a living. So of course they couldn't afford to buy 100 acres, so they had to lease. And when the war was over, guess what? Nobody wanted to lease to them, so how could they go home? So those people were left adrift. Those are the ones who stayed in the camps until they saw those propaganda photos of us happily resettled, and they had to be pushed out of the camps in order to close the camps. So those folks went to Chicago and New York and around the United States, other places. So in my father's case, partly because he had a fruit orchard, which he started from scratch because he grew up as a rice paddy farmer. He knew nothing about fruit farming, so he had to work for at least seven years after he started. Well, first he had to cut down the timber on the land he bought, which is way up in the boondocks. He had to build a road up to it with a horse and tools and even a 30-30, he had to shoot the bears and the deer and things that got in his way. He worked very hard, and by 1941, he actually owned 3 orchards, had no mortgages, had money in the bank. I have not met another Japanese-American family who could say the same thing. We own 3 properties, no mortgages, money in the bank.
Have you met anyone who could say they own 3 farms, 3 homes? I mean, can you live with a mortgage or rent for 3+ years and no income?
And have 7 kids to grow, to raise.
Exactly.
So he had enough money in the bank to pay the taxes and all that sort of stuff on his farms while they had no income in camp. That is why they were the 0.5 percenters that had a home to come home to. Most people lost everything.
And one of the greatest heartbreaks my father had was the second piece of property that he got. Was from a neighbor in, when we were in camp in Heart Mountain, Wyoming, the neighbor wrote and said, the person who's leasing your orchard is not taking proper care of it, and it's affecting the fruit and my trees. Do something about it. So we're in our 3rd year of incarceration, no income, and if we didn't have any money in the bank and we had mortgages, that's even worse. And my father knew that the man had ulterior motives, so he just didn't reply. And he kept sending messages. Finally, he said, if you don't do something, I'm going to take you to court. So now we have to try to hire a lawyer with no money and stuck in camp. And so my dad finally gave up because our perennial question is, are we ever going to ever be released? When will it happen? How long will it be from now? What will have happened to our properties in our absence? And so he gave up and he sold the property to the neighbor, which is what he wanted. And it was, as young as I was, I knew there was some kind of heartbreak involved with that property because of that. My father having to give up that property, which had gone so bad, he had to take out all the old trees, replant it with new young trees. They'd just come into their full harvest of 7 years, and guess what? Pearl Harbor happens. So he didn't get to reap any of the benefits of his labors on that property, which in the first place, I mean, when he sold it, he knew was for ulterior motives. And so when we go on a Sunday drive, my brother would say, well, let's go for a Sunday drive. And my dad would say, where are you going? And, well, we don't know where we're going. We're just going for a Sunday drive. And my dad would say, well, I think I'll stay home. I need to water the sun. And he'd make some excuse. And it wasn't until years later I realized he was afraid he would have to see that property, which was on a side road which we wouldn't ordinarily travel unless we're going there, or when we go to town, we go the other direction. And that property is across from the country club. So you imagine today how valuable that property is today. That's a question back there.
I'm probably the only Mexican that doesn't know any Spanish except the word Estrada. Are you bilingual with your siblings, and is she bilingual?
The question is, are you bilingual? Can you speak Japanese? And are your siblings bilingual?
I'm bilingual in that I can talk to any Japanese person, they can understand me. But when I first went to Japan and was teaching in a Japanese school, they immediately knew from my first speech that my parents were probably farmers and uneducated and from southern Honshu, and my father's language is masculine, therefore it's vulgar for me to use. They all laughed at me. The first lunch, the noon bell rang, and I said what my father always said out in the orchard. He'd say, well, there it's noon, let's go home and eat. And it came out like, man, or my guts yowling, let's go have chow. They understood me perfectly. I improved my Japanese so much that when I came home and walked into my parents' home to greet them, and the first few things I said, they both looked like this. Well, so you're a highfalutin city slicker now, huh? But I can go right back to my parents' speech. I can be just as vulgar or masculine as I was back then if I want to. But I've polished my Japanese so that I'm sort of acceptable now. But reading and writing is something else.
The last trip that Mom and I made to Japan, I needed to get a SIM card for my cell phone. So we went into a local cell phone shop. And because Mom is older, she's treated with a great respect. And so the person in the store was speaking very, very polite, respectful, high, respectful Japanese, plus technical cell phone stuff. She couldn't understand, so we had a Japanese friend translating very high, polite Japanese to more
rural.
Basic, rural, and non-technical to me, and then I explained to Mom. It was pretty funny.
Do you speak Japanese, sir?
Only a few words and phrases. I'm trying to study. We're going to take Mom to Japan in November.
My nieces and nephews all like to go to Japan with me because I know all the places to stay. I know all the relatives. We don't have to pay for hotels. We're treated like kings and queens. So each trip we've had different cousins tag along. I should tell a joke about Toby coming home after his freshman year in college. And my husband said, "Well, Toby, when are you going to study foreign language?" And he said, "Well, I did. I took German all through high school." He said, "Well, that was high school." And so my husband and I had an agreement from the beginning that in our child-raising techniques, we always supported each other fully. And if one of them made a statement in front of the child, then the other supported that. Well, I was hit with a bomb on that one when he said that to Toby. And Toby turned to me and said, "Well, Mom, do I have a choice?" Because that was a rule in our family. Our boys all had choices. And I said, "Well, I guess you have a choice of which language you study." I got out of that one.
I'd like to speak a little further too. Mom's generation, and I'm the youngest of all my cousins, and Mom's generation and my cousins, most of them pronounce the family name Asai, and that's, if you go to Hood River, everybody knows the Asais. But the proper Japanese pronunciation of the name is Asai, and I would say that the younger generation, I'm kind of in between the second and third generations, or third and fourth generation. I'd say the fourth generation is going back to the proper pronunciation of the name, Asai. So Mom says Asai most of the time. I say Asai.
And Toby's the only one who got my family name as a middle name. We vacillated about giving David and Ken, my second son, a middle Japanese name.
Or a Japanese name at all.
Japanese name at all. And we backed out of those and for fear that they might not be happy having a Japanese name. But Toby was very happy to get the Asai name. And from the time he could write, he started heading his school papers with Toby and Asai written in the kanji that I taught him how to write. Loftus, he's very proud of that. The last page of my present book tells about my great niece, it would be Jessica, who is an attorney in Portland. And I thought I didn't know her because she was born after I left Hood River to go to college and never went back. And so she's an attorney in a big tall building in Portland. I thought, well, I'll just go see what's like. So I got there and the doors of the building was just opening. It had maybe 6 or 8 stories. And there was a big desk with a receptionist. And I went up to her and said, "Has Jessica Asai arrived yet?" And she gave me this stern look and said, "You mean Asai?" And I said, "Yeah, that one." That's the last page of my book.
Any other questions? Yes, please.
I'd just like to say that I have enjoyed this thoroughly. I'm so glad that David told me about it. I have read the book. It's wonderful. And I
didn't pay her.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
At home, did the Issei speak Nongo?
At home, did the Issei, that is your parents, speak Japanese?
Yes, my parents always spoke Japanese to each other, unless they were going to chastise them or insult them, then they speak English. The children, we spoke Japanese to my parents, English to each other. My oldest brother flunked the first grade because he didn't have any siblings and he couldn't speak enough English, so he failed and he had to do first grade over again. So all of the rest of us benefited from our siblings because the siblings always spoke. And when my friends would come home to visit me and my home, I was ashamed to speak English or Japanese, so I always, if my mother or my father would say something to me in Japanese, I would answer them in English. They could understand perfectly, and I could understand their Japanese perfectly, but it was considered disrespectful, you know, to shout back in a different language when you could speak theirs. So there was that social aspect.
There was another question, yes.
How large was the Japanese population in Hood River when she returned from the camp?
How large was the Japanese population in Hood River before and after camp?
I believe I read some statistics that said there were something like 365 people who were put on the train on May 13th, 1942. And I'm guessing that there are about that many people in Hood River now, although many didn't come home, they're all the children and the grandchildren who have inherited the lands and are still there. I have a nephew in my birth home. I have a niece up the road and another nephew up the road. They're farming. And so there are at least there are one, two, three, there are actually four orchard families that are connected to me still in Hood River. So, and that's more than most families in Hood River.
Most families lost everything. And so, for example, Seabrook Farms in New Jersey was really, really hurting for workers. So they invited Japanese Americans out of camp to come. And so there's a sizable Japanese American community there. Many went to Chicago and other places. They had nothing on the West Coast. Anyone else?
I have a childhood playmate who lived up the road from me. It was like a quarter mile, and she'd come halfway, I'd come halfway. So I that was the only playmate I had on a regular basis as a child. So you can imagine how happy I was at camp with all these kids everywhere. And we didn't want to sit. We sat, there were tables of about 12 people in the mess hall, and they didn't want to sit with their parents when they had all their friends everywhere else. I was a very obedient child. I think I always sat with my parents, but they would never force me if I wanted to sit with my friends, but I stayed with them. But many families, the family unit started breaking apart with the camp experience because of things like that. Kids just didn't want to sit with their parents when they could be with their friends. I wrote a postcard to my childhood friend that I'd met a quarter mile apart. She lives in Wisconsin, and I said, I've just gotten a new edition of my book out that I want you to read because your name is on page such and such, and your brother's name is on page such and such. And she sends me a postcard. She said, I already have a book, your book, and I've read it. And I said, but how could you? I had email. I said, how could you? The book was printed by Oregon State University Press. She said, I got it through the University of Chicago Press. I said, oh my gosh, I didn't realize the University of Chicago Press actually prints the book. I'd be happy to answer any questions afterwards if you'd like to ask them later.
Thank you all so much for coming.